Good evening. I want to thank everyone for coming. My name is Lizzie Scheimer. I'm with the League of Women Voters. We are holding our candidate forum, and I want to first acknowledge all of the co-sponsors, the lead organizations, our Democracy NC and Children First Communities and Schools. Additionally, we have the American Association of University Women, the YWCA of Asheville, Warren Wilson College, Carolina Jews for Justice, Spirit in Action, Western North Carolina Community Health Centers, and the Council on Aging of Buncombe County. I wanted to make a couple of housekeeping announcements. Restrooms are out the back door to the right and around the hallway about halfway down the right-hand side. Please silence your cell phones, and please use the appropriate trash receptacles. I wanted to give a little bit of a discussion about the format of the evening. All candidates were invited. Some candidates were not able to attend. All of the co-sponsors of this event are nonprofit, nonpartisan organizations, which means we have to adhere to the 501c3 standards. If there is an opponent that is not able to attend, we are unable to hold empty chair debates. And so therefore, the candidates who do not have an opponent here will be given a timed amount to speak on stage. The candidates whose opponents are here will have a moderated discussion. And then afterwards, we encourage everyone in the public who is attending to please take that time to speak one-on-one with all candidates to make sure that you're able to be the most informed and understand the issues that are important to you. I wanted to just briefly note that our mission is that we are a nonpartisan organization that encourages informed and active participation in government, works to increase understanding of major public policy issues, and influences public policy through education and advocacy. The League of Women Voters shall not support or oppose any political party or any candidate. All leagues bear the responsibility of safeguarding this nonpartisan policy and the organization's nonpartisan reputation. For the candidates in attendance, we have two timers up front. You will be given a 30-second notice, and then there will also be a stop. You are able to complete your sentence when the stop comes up, however, you're not allowed to move forward from there. And I am now going to announce Greg Borum, who is one of our co-sponsor agency representatives from Children First.
Thanks, Lizzie. Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for taking your time to be here. We know that election season in the fall, just in general, is a busy time with lots of things going on and competing for your time and attention. We want to say a special thanks to all the candidates that did take time to be with us tonight. They also get pulled in so many ways during campaign season. We hope that this event provides good information and a chance to connect with folks running for office and gives you a chance to hear a little bit more about them. I want to make a note, too, that our other partner for this event, Democracy NC, has hot off the presses voter guides for state offices, and those are available outside on the table as you came in. Please make sure you pick up one of those and use it for being an informed voter. I want to introduce our moderator for tonight. We're happy to have Carolina Public Press serving as our moderator. And tonight's moderator is Michael Gebelein. He is a journalist with Carolina Public Press. He's been an investigative reporter since 2016. After working 8 years in community journalism, he was born in Baltimore, but grew up in Huntersville and lived in Western North Carolina since 2005. So he's got that going for him. He is a graduate of Appalachian State University with a double major in journalism and psychology. Seems like the right credentials for being an investigative reporter. Mike, we're so glad to have you here tonight. Thanks for moderating, and Mike is here. So welcome.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming out. I'd like to send just a word of gratitude to all of you for coming out and to the candidates for being present this evening. We'll get right into it with candidates for Buncombe County Commission District 2. So please come up to the stage. Now, from my understanding, the candidate we have for this district this evening is Nancy Nelson. So she will be giving some remarks, and so long as Representative or opponent is not here, we'll go ahead and get started.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you very much for joining us here this evening. I'm Nancy Niels Nelson. I'm a Weaverville resident. I'm running for Buncombe County District 2 Commissioner. I want to join Ellen Frost, who is a seated commissioner from District 2, and we both want to make Buncombe County even better. As a candidate and as a politician, I feel that it was my duty and my obligation and my sincere delight to be here this evening to work with you and the other candidates. Thank you very much. I'm a retired Bell Laboratories project manager. I have background in both consumer psychology and in project management. I believe that both of those formal educational backgrounds will allow me to bring some significant voice to the County Commission. As I said, I'm a Weaverville resident, and I have three things that to me are my most important platform issues. One is the education to the fullest extent of the law that Buncombe County support not only our children, but our teachers, and we partner as much as we can as partners, not adversaries, with the state government, who is in dire need of a redirection of how they are funding and supporting traditional public education in the state of North Carolina. I'm not going to say any more about that. I'm going to let my friend John Aker talk a little bit about that, but I'm looking forward to working with him to move the state back to a place where our county doesn't have to pick up the pieces every time the state doesn't do their job in education of our children. The second platform I have is to make sure that the county services that are available to people in Buncombe County, not only do people know what they are, but they know how to access them and where to access them. We just opened the Family Justice Center downtown Asheville. This is a place where people from all over the county can come if they need help with domestic violence issues. My concern is if somebody in Fairview or Broad River or Barnardsville needs to get there, first they need to know about it, and second they need to know how to get there. My third issue is continuing to keep our economic forces strong. And one of the ways I want to do that is to review and update our land use ordinances. For 10 years, John Aker and I have sat on the Land Conservation Advisory Board, and we've been able to save almost 17% of the land masses here in Buncombe County from any kind of future development. That is a tool and a toolkit to make sure that land use, including development and building out of Asheville, is not only controlled, but it's guided. I don't want developers coming to our county without knowing right up front what they can and cannot do. And right now our county's done a great job of that. I want to add to that. I want to add to that toolkit. Those are the three things that I think are most important to the people in my district. I've spent the last, since December 18th, out talking to people in my district. We have 31 precincts in District 2. We have 66,000 voters. We have 60,000 voters. And those are the numbers, and also a huge landmass of the people we're dealing with. But I'm trying to visit with as many people as I can. Right now, we've covered about half the precincts. We're hoping by November 8th, actually by October 20th, that we are with some more people. I invite you to go to my website, which is www.electnancynielsnelson.org. Thank you very much.
I live over at Hickory Nut Gap Farm. We're we're having our 100th year anniversary this year. John, you able to come to that? John is a former farm manager, so we got to get you in on that. I married my wife Annie 45 years ago. We raised four sons. I have two sons in the military, and I have two others that are running small businesses that they have helped create. I'm a Jim Hunt Democrat. I believe in education as the way to move North Carolina forward. We have got to recommit ourselves to a strong education program from pre-K to the university. I believe in clean air and clean water. Especially in the mountains, that is our calling card to attract businesses, jobs, retirees, and besides that, it's my passion to work hard to keep our air and water clean. We need to work hard. We need to recommit ourselves to election reform, end the gerrymandering, the voter suppression, and try to get money out of politics. I am ready to repeal HB2 and end the bleeding our state is experiencing. We once were known as a state with great education, a great university system, and fabulous basketball. Now we're known as the state that passed HB2. I have a very special interest in helping small farmers, small mountain farmers, stay in business. My opponent owes the voters of Buncombe County an apology for his smear campaign. He knows the truth, but chooses to peddle a sham narrative about HB 1021. I know he knows the truth because when he asked me about it, I sent him the truth. For those that have gotten the nasty mailers, I've been endorsed by the League of Conservation Voters, the Buncombe County Association of Educators, the North Carolina Association of Educators, North Carolina Police Benevolent Association, State Employees Association of North Carolina, and the Sierra Club. I would ask that come October 20th, and if not then, November 8th, that you would please consider voting for me, John Ager. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Representative. Now we'd like to welcome to the stage the State Senate District 49 candidates, incumbent Senator Terry Van Dyne and William Meredith. So let's begin with the first question. I'd like to know, what is your opinion on House Bill 2, and what, if anything, do you believe will happen in the upcoming session related to this legislation? And we'll let Senator Van Dyne answer first, please.
HB 2 is an omnibus discrimination bill. It makes it legal in North Carolina to fire someone simply because they are gay. And that's just plain wrong. It also prohibits cities and counties from passing ordinances with respect to employment, even contractors that they employ with taxpayer dollars. That's also wrong. I filed a bill early in session to completely repeal HB 2. It didn't make it out of committee, but I will continue to speak out against HB 2. Unfortunately, the state legislature has not shown any willingness to work across the aisle on HB 2, and so I think it will be up to the courts to fix this problem.
The Libertarian Party has a very clear position on HB 2. We stand behind repealing it completely. We're known as the party. We don't have a position on what you do in your private life is your private life. The government has no business being involved in that. There should have been no laws made in the first place regarding these issues. To me, the Republican and Democrat deadlock is one of the reasons I became Libertarian. So if you want to see some movement across the aisle, you know, Libertarian might be the best chance of working with Republicans on repealing that.
Carolina provides adequate funding for public education. Mr. Mayor, your response first, please.
Well, it depends on who's defining the word adequate, doesn't it? The current budget allows 57% of our entire state expenditures go into education. That's somewhere around $22 billion a year. That's an enormous sum of money to a blue-collar guy like myself. And I haven't had a raise in my industry in 20 years. Welders have not seen a raise in 20 years. So it's kind of hard for me to go to the working public and say that we need to take more money out of your check to give to education when they already receive $22 billion a year. I think maybe there's some efficiency within that budget we could look at to push some raises to the bottom. Maybe some administrators could take some cuts. There's something to look at there, I think.
We are currently 44th in per pupil spending. That is not acceptable. I visited schools without adequate textbooks, and we are demoralizing our teachers. So I think it is, at the same time, we have cut corporate income taxes every year since I've been in the legislature. So for me, it's a question of priorities. Are tax cuts your priority, or is providing great schools your priority? And for me, it's providing great schools.
Thank you. Governor Pat McCrory has sent a proposal to the federal government that would overhaul and privatize many aspects of the state's Medicaid program. Do you believe the governor's proposal is the right course of action? And also, what should the future of Medicaid look like in North Carolina? Senator Pat McCrory.
I'm very concerned about that plan. What it does is it takes us from a fee-for-service scheme to a capitated, that means fee per patient. And my concerns are that in states that have done this already, insurance companies have absorbed that risk and taken 17% off the top. That means there's less money to provide health care. And in fact, in Florida, fewer than 50% of the doctors take Medicaid patients. So I am very concerned about this plan.
Well, as a libertarian, the chance to privatize anything is a great move. Just because you have health insurance doesn't mean you have health care. As a veteran and who has a lot of friends who interact with the VA, I can tell you that government-sponsored healthcare is not worth very much. Okay, private healthcare delivers the best healthcare. We have the best healthcare on the planet because of our private healthcare industries. I would like to see us move in the direction where people could afford their own healthcare. If we could fix some of the problems keeping working people from being able to get ahead, maybe they wouldn't need insurance and they could pay for their healthcare.
Thank you. North Carolina and Charlotte have been in the news recently because of protests related to the shooting death of an African-American man by a Charlotte police officer. Legislation that becomes law on Saturday eliminates the public's ability to view police body camera footage without a court order. What is your opinion of that legislation and, more broadly, of the Black Lives Matter movement as a whole? I would like to have Mr. Mayor answer that question first, please.
I'd like to say that it's quite a lot in that one question to answer in a short amount of time, but I'm going to do my best. The reason I became a libertarian is because libertarians have always been against the drug war. The drug war, listen to the language, it's a war. What do you have in war? You have enemies, you have good guys, and you have bad guys. The police see themselves as the good guys, they see us as the public as the enemy. We're the enemy. It doesn't matter if you're black, white, yellow, or purple polka dots, you're the enemy to the police. We need to end the drug war to end the stigma of us versus them and then occupying the force versus the enemy. That's what's leading to the greatest violence.
Senator Pamela?
What the DOJ report on Ferguson showed us is that throughout law enforcement, African Americans are treated differently than white people. And we need to wrestle with that. We need to figure out how to fix that. So that's part of the question. I did vote for that bill that's, and I've had, it was a difficult vote for me to take. I totally agree with transparency. I think it was a badly conceived bill, but I had a choice to vote for it or against it, not to fix it, unfortunately. I do think we need transparency, but I was concerned about people being tried on the 6 o'clock news. And so I think we need some structure around these videotapes. I think the public has a right to access them, but we need some guidelines about when is appropriate so that we don't, for example, make it difficult for a district attorney to prosecute a crime when one is committed.
Thank you. North Carolina currently requires people who want to purchase a handgun to have either a pistol purchase permit issued by the county sheriff or a concealed carry permit. No such permit is required for people who want to purchase rifles or shotguns. What is your opinion of the current state of gun laws in North Carolina? And I will start the senator in that, please.
Okay. I am a proponent for better gun registration. I think not only are there too many gun deaths, but when you consider that two-thirds of gun deaths are actually suicides, I think we just have too many guns in this country, and we need to do something about that. And I think common sense registration of all kinds of weapons just makes sense.
I have the exact opposite view. Registration leads to confiscation. Confiscation led to the Holocaust. The only difference between free people and slaves is the right to keep and bear arms. If you try to limit someone's right to keep and bear arms, that is a tyranny enacted upon the people. The current laws in North Carolina are fairly sufficient as far as guns go. I have used a firearm in defense of my life before, and I would not want to be disabused the right to defend myself so that I could be live here talking to you today. Thank you.
Thank you. This is our last question. Should Republicans maintain control of both houses of the General Assembly after November's election, neither of you being a majority party, how would you work with Republicans to ensure the legislation that's important to voters of Buncombe County gets passed? And we'll start with Mr. Mayor, please.
Well, as a libertarian, I occupy a unique position in the political spectrum. You know, we cross a lot of bridges with the left and the right that we share common ground with, and so I find it very easy to work with people from multiple parties and have done so on a lot of issues over the years. I think the Republicans would be very friendly to a libertarian voice simply because there's no rules in the playbook yet that says they can't talk to each other.
Well, I worked very hard over the last 4 years to establish relationships with my Republican colleagues in the Senate. We have worked together on a number of bills, and I expect to be able to do so going forward.
Thank you. In closing, I would like to ask each of you all for two minute statement. I will begin with Mr. Mayor, please.
As you know, my name is William Merritt, and I'm 47 years old, and I got an environmental science degree here at the UNCA in the early 90s. I spent my entire life as a blue-collar working guy, as a welder, metal fabricator, small business owner, labor provider. I've struggled very hard to maintain a living in this region. I know exactly what it's like to be to try to balance a lot of things in your life, your concern for the environment, your concern for your pocketbook, your concern for the future of your family and your country. And these are all the things that pushed me into politics. Mainly I came to it during the drug war and the legalization movement, which I still feel has a long way to go, and a lot of our social problems are attributed directly to the drug war separating our society into enemy combatants and good guys and bad guys. And I'd like to bring that to a stop, and hopefully, if elected, I will be able to be in Raleigh every day, knocking on governor's door. I haven't passed the Penn Scales medical marijuana bill yet, and if you put me up there, that'll be my primary drive. Thank you.
First, I want to thank the League of Women Voters and Children First Community Schools and Democracy NC for sponsoring this and for all the work they do every day. And I'd like to thank you all for being here. My name is Carrie Van Dyne, and I am very honored to serve most of Buncombe County in the North Carolina Senate, and I'm here to ask you for your vote today. We are a state with the wrong priorities. For example, since I have been in the legislature, we have cut taxes for the wealthy and corporate taxes every single year. Meanwhile, we have raised tuition at our universities and community colleges. That's not the right priority. We expect our teachers to work without textbooks, yet we forward funded vouchers to the tune of $100 million over the next 10 years. Our refusal to take the Medicaid expansion has not only cost billions of your tax dollars to move out of our state to other states, but it's cost us 25,000 good-paying healthcare jobs and literally causes hundreds of people to die needlessly every year. And finally, I would be remiss if I did not mention HB 2. As I said, it legalizes discrimination and has people all over the world asking what is going on in North Carolina. So I have stood up on the floor of the Senate for our schools, for our environment, for human rights, and I want to do that again. So that's why I'm here tonight asking for your vote.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Schools and all of our co-sponsors, thank you for coming out.